take a careful look at the photograph in front of your screens, okay? And tell me, who is this? Yeah? The first thought that comes to my mind is maybe a terrorist, Al-Shabaab, or perhaps a certain thug in some Kayole downtown place. Yeah, I would be certain this is a bad guy, not a good guy. Yeah, you know, you remember how we watch movies, they're the bad guys and the good guys, yeah? The good guys are supposed to be the cops, the people keeping law and order. The bad guys are supposed to be the criminals and the thugs. So where would you classify this guy? Without any thinking, definitely with the bad guys. Oh, but I have a surprise for you. This guy is a cop. Yep, he works for the Kenya Police Service. Still don't believe me? Let me convince you. I know you'll need a lot of convincing. Is the same guy right behind Professor Ndii and James Orengo. This was when Ndii was about to be released. Yes, released from where? Released from police custody. Released from the police custody of that guy. Yes, that guy, that policeman. Yep, and that same again, right in front of Professor Ndii, just before the NASA strategist, or rather as the NASA strategist was being released from police custody. Yeah, we all saw this photograph. It was widely circulated all over the place. Now, let me fill you in on a bit of background, okay? The police the world over, including Kenya, have people who are called plainclothes policemen, okay? Plainclothes policemen normally dress smartly, okay? They normally identify themselves as police, yes. And then we also have another group of people called undercover agents or undercover policemen, okay? Now, the work of undercover policemen is obvious. They're supposed to operate close to criminals, close to where crime is about to take place, so that they gather evidence, they gather inside information, so that the police can later come in and nab them. Now, for their own safety, undercover policemen are never ever revealed as being policemen. When the true identity of an undercover policeman is discovered, that the person is actually a policeman, we say the cover has been blown. Yeah, and this not only endangers the life of the policeman, but it also endangers the lives of other people he may have gotten to cooperate in gathering evidence against criminals. Now, forgive my long lecture, because it is very important for the sake of the point I'm about to get across. I've just given you the only reason why a police officer should dress the way this gentleman dresses, okay? But this gentleman is not undercover. This gentleman pronounces himself as a policeman. Yes, he's a member of the flying squad. Yeah, he goes around with the flying squad, and when they pick up people, they identify themselves as policemen. Now, we know since the dramatic 8th of August elections and before, quite a number of foreigners have been picked up by this flying squad and mostly deported. Off the top of my head, there are some people from Ghana who are going to assist NASA on some technical issues with parallel tallying centers and adopt a polling station and all that. Yeah, we even know there was even a mzungu, a political expert who had come into the country on a tourist visa, unfortunately, but he doubled himself in trying to advertise NASA, so that guy was deported using this flying squad. Now, I want you to imagine that you're in a foreign country, and you get arrested by somebody who's dressed like this, and they tell you they are a policeman. What image would you have of that country? What image would you have of that police force? Anyway, the situation in Kenya is such that there's such a brutal, determined struggle for power that the image of the country is no longer important. Yeah? Because we're doing all kinds of things that are putting the repute of the country called Kenya in a very bad place. Yeah, maybe I can give you the most recent example. You pick up an economist, you don't charge him, you release him. Yeah, a world-renowned economist, And why have you picked him up? Because you don't agree with his views. My apologies. You thought that there was free speech in Kenya? Think again. You thought that Kenya has a constitution, a very beautiful constitution that is adhered to? Think again. But then our mystery remains. Why have somebody dressed like this in your flying squad? Yeah? Why retain somebody like this in a crack squad? Yes, which I talked about yesterday. I don't repeat myself. Yeah? The purposes and objectives of that squad. Okay? They carry very big guns. Yes, that should give you a hint. So why retain somebody like this in a police unit? Why? What would the purpose be? Now, let me give you some information you might not have. When Dr. Ndii was picked up at Diani, he was driven overnight to Nairobi. Okay? And as he was being driven, he was being interrogated. Okay? Now, we understand during the journey back to Nairobi, the car, the vehicle which he was traveling in was stopped several times in the middle of nowhere and in darkness. Now, I want you to imagine something. Imagine you're in a vehicle with this guy. He's very terrifying, isn't he? No doubt about that. And as you travel in the dark of the night, the vehicle is stopped several times, and this guy carrying a big gun is one of the policemen who is holding you captive. I would be terrified. Most people would be terrified. Now, that is called psychological torture, okay? But let's leave that at that, okay? And let's move to another more important point about what a policeman should be. A policeman is supposed to be above everything else to uphold the law of the land, okay? When a policeman operates outside the law of the land, that is called a rogue policeman. But it seems in Kenya, we have use, very important use, for rogue policemen. And they're retained in squads like the flying squad. Now, we have a first-hand experience of some of the antics of these rogue policemen, including the policeman on our photograph. Okay? And I'll read it verbatim from an eyewitness, somebody who was there, somebody who experienced this whole drama unfold. And I read, the caliber of people that were escorting David Ndii from Mlimani Courts and later to Pangani Police Station are no better than terrorists, if their demeanor and physical outlook are anything to go by. First, we got into the court precincts with Apollo Mboya, Otiende Amolo, and Edwin Sifuna, before we were later joined by NASA CEO Norman Magaya, the vibrant youth currently under heavy police surveillance. 20 minutes later, a sleek Subaru Outback with siren followed by a red pickup made their way into the court precincts, and the first person to alight from the convoy was a flying squad Somali guy with a bulging cheek full of miraa and an Arafat wrapped around his head. Now interrupt. That's definitely our guy. Ama? Yep, that's definitely our guy. Let me continue reading. Then other six rogue members followed, gestured indeed to alight from the car, and publicly flaunted their guns as they led Ndii into the basement cells of the court. The flying squad leader was, however, very polite to the whole defense team, cooperating by briefing us about the meeting that the prosecution team had after they realized that the charges were frivolous and vexatious and could not even stand trial at the Kikuyu Council of Elders. To avoid a state of induced shame, they opted not to adduce him before the jury, because he had a cogent defense to tear that hopeless case apart and forcefully feed the remaining tattered pieces of paper to the prosecution musketeers. Immediately, a signal from the DPP's office came that Ndii should be released on police cash bail. He was again led back into the Subaru, but those flying squad officers had an ulterior motive of abducting and forcefully disappearing with Mr. Ndii. This was not their lucky day to make a minced meat out of a human body, because the two reputable lawyers who successfully convinced a bench of six judges to annul the elections of their ringleader was with them step by step. Orengo and Sifuna got into Orengo's car. Otiende, Apollo, and Magaya got into Otiende's car. Okay? Then some junior counsel, the two bodyguards, ODM Nairobi youth leader popularly known as Jonah, and I got into Sifuna's car. and the officers immediately communicated that we're heading to Mudhaiga police station. There was some traffic snarl up at Gong Road that joins Kenyatta Avenue, and so the chase car started clearing the way for us to pass before we joined Nyerere Road. At the intersection of Nyerere Road and University Way, the Subaru carrying Ndii passed out, but the pickup obstructed us for like a minute, and that is where we knew something mischievous was cooking. Orengo got out of the car and personally stopped those other cars from the other side of Uhuru Highway, trying to gain entry into areas around University and Nairobi so that the pickup and the whole convoy could pass. We then directly joined Thika Road from University Way, where there were a fleet of cars. The Outback, being small, started speeding off in between the cars so that we could not catch up with it. But since we were in a V8, we could catch up. We could watch every theatric we were being treated to. The traffic jam then opened up abruptly, and then we were almost reaching Pangani flyover. The two police cars took the extreme right lane, which leads to a U-turn back to town, and we immediately confirmed our suspicion that these people wanted to abduct Ndii. If you want to get to Mudhaiga police station, you have to use either the left or the middle lane. And since we were very much aware of their plans, we also stuck on the same left lane. They then took a U-turn, and see how we also took a U-turn, and so that we could be right behind them. Since they had no option because we had already caught up with them, they then diverted to Pangani Road that leads to Pangani police station. We reached the gate of the station, and when we were alighting, the Somali guy with an Arafat just blatantly told us, and I quote, "Muko na bahati leo, nyinyi mmekuwa na sisi bumper kwa bumper. Hii ingebaki kuwa story, lakini mkajanjaruka." Do I really need to join the dots for you? Ladies and gentlemen, my fellow Kenyans. Wah! Drama bin drama, Arab drama. That is Kenya for you. Na hapo ndo maendeleo imetufikisha. Until next time, this is Chris Kumekuja.